All right. To recap a little, what has been done until now is where we have the epic with the idea of a three-year vision mox and to create this prototype for various purposes. And then it was set out to be made by me and Hayana. And there were some existing flows detailed out and there were like the bigger picture. We decided, like me and Ayana met up last week and we decided to go over the overall kind of like how things align, how things correlate. And then we also found that there were already existing flows that were meant to be prototyped out. So that's where we focused on this week in order to see how far we could get and bring something to the table for today's discussion. How about I give it to you, Ayana, to kind of walk us through the flows.
Awesome. Let me open up the issues here. Right, I'm going to go over flow B first because I'm most familiar with it. Let me share my screen. And then what I want is really feel free to interrupt me, give feedback, ask questions. Because while I was prototyping this, I felt like, need some, you know, a pair of extra eyes here to see if the context of the information that I'm adding to the screens makes sense. And also if from a broader point of view, if the flows would actually connect. So as we know, the flow B was about deployment approvals, runbooks, review apps, feature flags, and the release page. And I tried to adapt to the overall, like the overarching goal was this, this exercise is to create this experience that embeds the flow in GitLab. So the first step here would be that the user receives a notification or an email saying that, hey, you have a deployment to approve. For this example, I used on a pre-production deployment. Again, if the information doesn't make sense on the screen, it's because I need more context on what specific steps the user would be.
So far, this deployment looks okay from my perspective. Ori, do you have any thoughts?
So far, so good. Let's walk through it.
The email. Good. All right. So the user receives the email saying, yeah, you have this thing to approve. You can approve or reject from here and then we'll take you to the different view or you can click view details. So say the user, yeah.
All right. This is like on the pipeline itself. Where do I see this window?
On your email. This is a...
On my email. Okay. Because it does look exactly like the email notification. okay.
Yeah, we did. I didn't really find that's another thing from the UX assets. We don't have emails prototypes, so I just had to create from an email.
By the way, that's like a feature that I've heard many, many customers ask for. How do I customize the email? But yes. Not our problem.
But it is a problem indeed. So I just created this based on an email I had in my my inbox. So user clicks view detail. And then they're taken to this view that shows what I understood and what also looking at the things that would be more or less like the cycle of this release that could be,
and so I do want to ask a question. Mm-hmm. The previous email, can I approve and reject directly from the email or do I need to go through GitLab to do that? Because I think in terms of permissions and security, I would prefer people to actually go through GitLab and not through the email itself, because an email can be forwarded and stuff like that. So I think that's something to think about.
That's a good point. In this prototype, I'll get there because I want to show the different flows.
In
the prototype, when you hit, for example, approve, you get to the review app and then you can approve from there. So you ideally need to log in to GitLab before you can access the view app.
But the review app, you don't have to be logged in. That's like, you don't have, anyone can use it. It's just a URL.
Yeah. So I think that when I wrote this flow, the intention was that the approve would take you inside of this view. And it wouldn't make you, it wouldn't actually send like a curl to click that button for you. It would take you to the screen to then approve.
Yeah. So I think it's a little bit confusing. I think Jackie spot on. That's exactly what we need to do. Get back to GitLab and then do that approval from GitLab when you're already logged in, you get audit log and everything is inside the system. So I think it's just a little bit confusing because to me, if I had that button, I would think that's what it's doing in email. So
that's kind of a pattern though in other companies where like you are, you click a button and it takes you to the next step. So maybe it's...
maybe approve / reject, like...
Yeah, it, like maybe just one button that says...
Exactly.
Go to GitLab to approve/ reject.
Yeah, like in the bottom of the any email that we get from GitLab, it says view it on GitLab. I think that's a good convention to keep.
Right.
Or maybe we just remove the approve. Well, I like the approve and reject buttons. I do like that, but I think that maybe view details is the only button that we should.
Yeah, maybe it could be something like that.
Exactly.
Or reject.
Yeah.
There you go. Okay, this is going to take a lot. We're let's go through the flow and I'll try to capture our feedback notes because I want us to get as much through this as possible.
Yes. And then feel free to, you can leave comments on these files. So feel free to drop comments here and then I'll make the updates async. Cool. So let's say a user clicks up a reject, they're taken to this, the view on the group release. And then you have your pre-deployment approvals and you can see here a list of things that are pending. Again, the data, it's not really, I think, what we should display here. I put the issue and then, yeah, the merge request, the pipeline, everything. And you can see what's pending, what's approved. You can click view app or from this page, approve or reject. If you click approve or reject, you have to confirm the approval or rejection. We can definitely do this in a different interaction, still on the screen without a modal. But the modal is a pattern that we have right now. And then you confirm your action, you leave a comment, and the status change on this screen, right? So for example, approved by Hayana. If I click on view app, and that's where I felt like a little bit adventurous. If you click on view app, I'm taken to the view app, which in this example is, and the view app of GitLab, so of our own product. So it might be a little bit odd, but you see that, okay, you were looking at the pending deployment number, whatever, by Gendo. You hit approve or reject, and then you're gonna have the same interaction with the modal where you can enter more details. We also have an example in the flow that says, okay, so it might be that there's a feature flag enabled, right? And then you have to approve with or without the feature flag. This example just shows that the message is different. You still have the option to approve or reject. But when you do, you get a different modal. Now, it's just you have the option to add notes here, but I forgot. And then you choose, okay, do you want to disable the feature flag with your approval? So enable or disable, that's going to define the status, right, for this for the deployment. And then after you did the approval or the rejection from this view or from the list view, you can see in the merge request a status of for your pipeline. So here I try to play around a little bit with what it would look like, mocking what we have for the merge request approval. But in this case, let's say the deployment was approved and now the pipeline starts running for that specific step. And then you can see who approved the pre-deployment and potentially see more details about, yeah, if there was a comment or what other approvals exist, who approved it, etc. And for the different use cases, when it's approved with the feature flag enabled, I just thought it would be nice to show some things here in the UI. And if you reject, the pipeline doesn't run, and then you can see there was rejected and the reason for rejecting it. So this is the flow B that will connect deployments, runbooks a little bit, feature flags and approvals.
So I have some questions because I was holding back not to stop you in the middle, I have to say. So one thing that I wanted to ask is the second screen you showed, that one, yeah. So this will only be showed if the previous steps succeeded, right, in the pipeline. So let's say I have like a bunch of jobs, stages, and then The previous one failed. I won't get to this, right? It's pending on the success of the previous stage.
I think where there is some confusion here is that we're not looking at a pipeline here.
Yeah, this would be like a runbook step, right? Like this would be kind of like a, well, not
okay. Really. So let's say notify Slack failed. I won't mm-hmm. get to pre-deployment approval, right? I understand this isn't a pipeline, but in that sense, anything that comes before, if it fails, it shouldn't continue, correct?
I think if you can have like pre-deployment approvals populated with stuff, but you won't be able to approve or reject unless if the steps are completed before. But there'll be information in that, I think, in my head. Like there'll be these pending items and approve and reject will be grayed out because you can't do anything with it.
Yeah, that's
good. They'll be there, I think, yeah. In my head.
Okay. Now can you go to the next, I'm not sure exactly which one, so just go through the flow. Okay, I really, really like this idea of having the approve and reject buttons on the review app. However, most of the review apps are a website outside of GitLab. So I'm not sure how we want to do that. If you think about the way visual reviews work today, which is kind of similar because you take action and you write comments that goes back to the merge request. You actually have to add snippets to every single page in your project, which is really difficult. And I think that's why a lot of people don't use it. So the question is, are we going to change review apps so that the URL is open from within GitLab and then you can still stay in that context? If not, I'm not sure that this is feasible.
Yeah, this is a 3-year vision though. I feel like if we can say that this is like a moonshot where we'd want to take review apps, I think that that's definitely something that we can incrementally deliver to. The intent of the screen to me, Ori, is that you can actually do something from the review app.
Yeah, and I really like that.
And I think what would be cool is if we make a feature improvement on review apps to allow this to be like an aggregation of your changes. So like you're not having to review just a point by point change. So if there's like a way to group review apps for review, that could even be like a feature enhancement that we make in year 2 from now, you know? But I completely agree, like there's some solutioning that we'll have to do from this. Yes. But directionally, I think it's important that this is a moonshot. And of course, like it's planning ambitiously. And I do feel like it captures something that you've said before around people wanting to interact with review apps more meaningfully.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. 100%. Okay, let's go to the next one. There's a pipeline view, and then there was something with feature flags.
So there's that modal that says enable, disable feature flags.
No, that's fine. That's fine.
You're okay with that?
I'm fine with that. You can continue. The other question is that this is per environment, right? Because the feature flag, I could have a feature flag on staging, but I'm, you know, doing production, so it's not the
right.
same. And then this is very cute. I don't know if we need to add into the 3-year plan that we want to have all of this like in an audit log and so on and so forth, because we do.
I love where your head's at though, that kind of ties into our compliance narrative, which was like a flow C. So maybe that's something that we can look at down the road, like all of this stuff then takes you to the audit report.
I just think that anything you do, especially if it's manually, you have to have it logged, have to.
Totally. If we use the merge request widget, and this is we're extending the merge request widget, then that would probably be, like merge request approvals are included inside of the audit logs. So maybe we would gain that benefit if we're extending merge request widgets to include deployments.
Maybe, maybe not. You never know. Hi, Anna. I wanted to ask you if you could make the feature flag here a URL in the text.
A link here?
Yeah.
Let me.
Because I think it just needs to link so that if someone wants to know what feature flag they're talking about.
Done. Yeah.
Very cool. And then what was the next one?
Just the last one. And the next one was a failed, like rejected.
No. Well, rejected is rejected. What can you do?
I think what would be interesting here is if it is rejected, linking back to like the GitLab run book, being like, what steps have to happen in order to get this approved kind of thing, bringing it full circle to how do we operationalize like a rejection or approval?
Something like some action. I'm just going to put a placeholder here.
Yeah, exactly.
Then you have a button to the run books.
Right.
Another cute thing that we can add is another email notification once this is approved. Yeah.
Look at you, or even Slack notification, like allowing
whatever notification
to hook out. I love that.
In the second flow, Dimitri is going to show we have with the Slack prototypes. Then you can have a look at it. That's it. Should I jump? We jump to the next one, Dimitri. I'll stop sharing, and then you can take over. This was awesome. Thank you for the feedback.
Sure. Let me get to it.
Well, actually, this is awesome to see. It's cool that some of these ideas that we've kind of flirted with or talked about are materializing. It's really cool.
I really like the fact that you can visualize it because I think, you know, a picture is worth 1,000 words.
All right, here we are with Flow A.
And we won't get stuck with that competition now that they have with find over goals because there's no text.
Which one?
There's a competition now to find like ambitious goals inside the handbook and get rid of them, I guess, for the IPL. But since there's no text, no one can nail us on that.
Yeah, we're just visuals.
All right, let's get to Flow A. Flow A is not as complete as the first one. We're missing out a little bit more information, or at least having a little bit of problem with how to visualize certain things in later steps, but beginning from a similar beginning point where the user receives a notification from Slack or email. I took the liberty to begin from an email here, but this could have been a Slack notification for all that we care. And that a deployment has been rolled back automatically with a link to the failed job and option to see the environment. So that's what we see here. We see here the failed deployment and then actually what has been done to kind of like resolve that. You know, it's been automatically rolled back to a previous deployment. So we see here where we are in the GitLab.com marketing page website project. And we've rolled back to a 1.3.1 release in this case. So you can view your environment, make sure that everything is all right. But you can also go into the alert, which has been highlighted here as well. Then on to the next point here, I've been going a little bit, being creative here, see how we can adjust the deployments page of an environment to be a little bit more informational, highlight the failed deployments immediately, and also to kind of see, hey, which deployment is currently active. So here we see that the failed deployment has actually been rolled back. When you click here on View Environment, you'll be redirected to this page. And you can see, all right, this is my currently past successful deployment. And this is the failed deployment that kind of triggered the auto rollback.
Before you continue, I think there's a problem with the terminology of failed deployment. And that might be my problem, like, because I started that terminology. But the deployment is successful, but there's something wrong post-deployment. So the deployment isn't really failed. Like, it could be, as we talked about yesterday, like CPU exploded all of a sudden, but the pipeline is green and in all sense, it's successful deployment. So I think we need to think about the terminology there.
Yeah, so you would say like this would be a successful one, but
there's a critical alert. So
okay. I do think there's two use cases though. There could be an area where there is a failed deployment. So for example, if you do have like a dependency that you're looking to deploy first and that dependency doesn't happen, then you would have a failed deployment.
It wouldn't get to the deployment stage in the pipeline.
You're totally right. It would be another status that's separate from a rollback. You know,
again. Yeah, so that's exactly it. It's a little bit, the terminology is confusing here.
Yes.
I also wonder if it's deployments versus releases, you know, like how do we want to, we don't have a deployment inside of like GitLab today, really, right? I mean, we have like a we have something that's deployed on an environment, but we don't have like the deployment object in the UI. Like we have the deployments API, right?
No, but we have, when you go into the environments, there's a tab with deployments, so we do have the information. Okay. We can bring it in.
Okay. Keep going. Sorry.
All right. So this is kind of the view that does that. So when you go into more detail on this, we kind of go towards the next step, and we see here, for example, that three issues have been created from this, you know, failure to deploy or this rollback that kind of, you know, created these issues. There is then a like a I see that Ayana is moving around this thing. There is this kind of pop out that you can hover over, see, you know, hey, do I want to assign a assignee or milestone directly from this view? But you also have the alternative to go into detail in this view. So you are redirected back to the runbook. Hey, I'm only in common mode. So you can see, all right, I repurposed the view from Hayana here a little bit and say, all right, we got three open issues, for example, security issue here and some other things that have gone wrong. You can select your assignee, you can select your milestone, you can view the issues that have been created and kind of, you know, make sure that we continue to progress the release in such a way.
I love this.
Yeah, this makes sense. I was wondering.
this combines monitor and security all together, which I think is really, really awesome. The one thing that I'm going to ask again, and I know we talked about this before, but we need to make sure that whatever we're showing here now, which may be an incident response event, or it may be a security event, that it's relevant to the specific environment that we're trying to do the runbook for, and not just have all the alerts again. Like it has to be specific to the specific environment and deployment that we're talking about.
Yes, but I, as far as I know, this runbook can be across multiple environments, right? So this is within a group view.
Right, but this auto rollback remediation needs to have like the details and context that it's for that specific job that you're rolling back. Like you're rolling back that job to a previous deployment.
To the specific environment.
Jackie, just a question for you. So mm-hmm. If we have one of these security issues like the CV something, 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 which is too small and I'm too old to read, someone may select to skip. You're allowed to say, like, ignore this, I'm not dealing with it now. That's okay. How does that come to play in terms of the runbook?
I think it would be an approve or reject, which was the same step that you saw before. And it would just be like, hey, are you sure you want to approve this? It has known vulnerabilities. And it would just be a manual override, which would, going back to your previous point, would be audited, would be in an audit log and an activity track. And then we can have a note that says approved with vulnerabilities by. So that's visually indicated in here. Going back to like Hyona's first flow, like that approval screen.
So just to get a little bit more like into this design here, how what kind of changes, what kind of information are you missing here specifically?
I think that this view, auto rollback remediation, I think it's good that you can assign people and select a milestone, but we do need to have acknowledgement that a rollback has been accepted. So like we may want to add a formal acknowledgement, a formal approval of a step that shows that like, okay, this rollback is okay. And we don't need to like fast forward a deployment.
That's interesting, because my assumption here was that, you know, you have your pre-deployment approvals, those have been accepted, then the rollback has gone in progress. That turned out to be wrong. Then an auto rollback has been created, and like that is a, like an accepted process. so that you immediately kind of pull forward towards, all right, how are we going to remediate and solve this solution to progress or release towards the one we want?
I see a couple of different ways to think about this. So on a continuous delivery cycle, there might be 3 or 4 pre-release candidates that somebody could select that are stable releases that they would want to promote to. And this case, it's going back to the last stable build, but somebody could actually say, actually, we fixed this in 1.33. So let's fast forward to 1.33. But from like a missing information standpoint, I'll defer to Orit, since rollbacks are kind of like her wheelhouse. But from this view, we need like a formal acknowledgement and approval that this is an okay step, because it's a system rolling back our code that we need to have like acknowledgement that that happened as expected.
Sounds good.
I think we should actually generalize this even more. So this step is called auto rollback remediation, but this could also be a manual step. So maybe skip the word auto and just have rollback remediation. And definitely if you have a manual step, you definitely want that as part of the runbook and the manual acknowledgement. I think we can make a lean acknowledgement system, if system is the right word, but you know, just a thumbs up, thumbs down icon here would be really, really cool. And then you could know exactly who wrote it down. And then maybe if we want, and this is more of Jackie's expertise, if someone rejects it and gives it a thumbs down, you're obligated to write why.
Exactly. And then you're formally acting that behavior. I do think what would be interesting here, Dimitri, is if we were to show related alerts or incidents from this, like.
So I think actually that's not needed, and I'll tell you why, because what Dimitri's showing here, Sarah already is doing like automatic issues from the alerts. So if we have all that in place, it's just an issue. So I'm not sure if we actually have to go back all the way to the alerts.
Which I guess is what this view issue is for, right?
Yes.
That little, okay, perfect. Then that captures it perfectly. Okay.
I would say that this, for example, this resolve CVE 1750 issue is tied to a security alert.
Love it. Perfect. Okay.
Sorry, just full of ideas today. What about adding the severity or some kind of label here so that someone knows, like just at a glance, how serious this problem is?
That's really good.
To be added. That sounds all great. I have to note, by the way, that this meeting is now 1 minute left in our time, and the next meeting is about to start. So do we want to continue this later?
We should have another follow-up on this, I think. Maybe we can incorporate the feedback that we received on the flows and then have a second follow-up meeting to continue.
Yes, I would love to invite both of you to kind of leave these kind of like little common dots all over our designs, because especially for the later on views, we are missing out some details or would love some additional explanation of what is actually expected here and kind of how it relates from one view to the next. That would help a lot.
And Dimitri, I'll engage you in the flow B or the flow A issue that I created. And maybe we can iterate in that issue on the last couple steps too, if we need clarity on that.
Yes, that would be great.
Okay, perfect. All right. Thank you all. This was fantastic. I'm so proud of you. This is amazing. Yeah, thank you.
It's really, really exciting. So thank you both.
Awesome. I'm just in love. Thank you guys.
Bye. That's because you're our newlyweds.
Bye, y'all.
Bye.